He's temperamental, he's complicated, he can be difficult, but Nigel Benn remains for many the most exciting figure in British boxing. Tonight is his ninth world title fight. The challenger, Henry Wharton, he's got an unbeaten record, he's never been knocked down. Wharton is the official number one contender. They paid £250 for ringside seats here at Earls Court. The fights pack them in. It's the main attraction of an awesome lineup. It also features two other big-name title fights. Michael Nunn defends his WBA version of the world super middleweight title against fellow American Steve Little. Next, it could be Benn or Eubank. And the old warrior Lloyd Hannigan, in the twilight of his career, but still a champion, he puts his Commonwealth title on the line. Hello, a very good evening to you all. There's a fantastic lineup of boxing talent here at Earls Court tonight. It's cost something like £3 million to assemble. Barry McGuigan is with me upstairs to enjoy it all. Barry will talk in just a moment. But topping our bill tonight, the Master Blasters, Henry Wharton and Nigel Benn.
Like, you know, watch Henry, my type of fighter, he likes to come forward, and I've just heard Mickey Duff put 10 grand on him. Well, why don't Mickey Duff come and meet me and I'll bet him 20 grand he'll knock me out. He's hungry and raring to go, you know? I just got to put out his fire, you know? Because I know he's going to come at me blazing, hey, but sometimes I think to myself, oh, yeah, I just calm him down a bit. But the only way to calm him down is give him a stiff right hand right in the face and make him think, like, well, you know, if you come in here, you know what you're going to get. I know he's got brilliant left hook, but so have I. So have I, and a right.
Nigel Benn's two epics against Chris Eubank produced a defeat and a draw, and massive viewing figures that underline the Dark Destroyer's box office appeal. For this fight, Benn's had a long training stint in the warmth of Tenerife. He's done his work, but relaxed as well, with some eyes being raised at the presence of his children. Nigel Benn's been talking about retirement, but he doesn't expect to do it tonight.
I ain't got a look for him. And he ain't got a look for me. That's what I want. If he's got a big punch and all that, I know he's got a big punch. Wait till he feels mine.
The challengers based his preparations out in Malaga. Henry Wharton has been number one contender for 15 months now, and he's ready.
I don't think I could have prepared any harder. You know, and I've been 12 rounds before. I've been through some real tough workouts, and I've come through them. And I've never worked as hard as this. You know, I've worked very, very hard in the gym, doing some real tough sparring, and I've come through it, and I'm just looking forward to the fight now.
We will be champion. I don't have the slightest doubt in my own mind. I'm very, very confident. He doesn't need any good luck to win. What he needs is to have no bad luck.
Wharton's way behind Benn on experience, just under half as many fights, but he's gone 19 unbeaten. His left hook is a fearsome weapon.
This is the toughest fight of my life, by a long way. You know, I know I'm going to have to really go through a lot of pain and suck it up, which I have done before. I know that I'm going to have to take bigger punches than I've ever took before. But the thing is, I've prepared for taking the big punches. You know, the question is, has Nigel Benn prepared to take him back off me?
Okay then, so terrific confidence there in both camps. Barry, who are you signing for?
Well, that's a difficult one to pick. You know, you've got Benn's experience, and he's fighting more like a veteran now, Jim. He's using his head more, he's boxing with more finesse, and using his boxing ability, he's more mobile as well. But then you've got Wharton, who's an all-out aggressive fighter. Only fights through one way, straight at you, non-stop. They both can really bang. And I'm going to favour the experience, and I think it's going to be Benn and a late either decision or stoppage.
Yeah, I'm not going to disagree with you on going for Nigel Benn, but the big question here, and all Wharton fans down below us are wondering, what's going to happen if Benn gets hit on the chin by that left hook?
What's going to happen if he gets hit by the left hook after the sixth round? Don't blink, folks. This is going to be over very quickly, I think. Or it could be over very quickly, but I have a feeling that I'm going to go with Benn. I've got to go with the experience. But the form book's been wrong before. The form book is Benn, but I'm definitely going to go with him. Wharton's such a tremendous puncher, you can never write him off. They've got a fabulous chance, but don't go making any cups today because this could be over in a hurry.
What about Nigel Benn, though? I mean, a few people are a bit surprised. He had his kids over in Tenerife. He's talking about retirement. Is that really the right mood to be going into this fight in?
Well, I've written him off before against Eubank. He goes into the ring with the wrong attitude. I thought he'd seen better days, but he's proved me wrong before. He's a very relaxed guy. He's more relaxed now than ever before. He's a better fighter, I believe. He's fighting with more finesse. He's boxing better. He's putting his punches together better. He's structuring his tactics better. Wharton, very strong, very dangerous puncher. Anything can happen. I'm going to go with Benn.
Okay. The sound behind us, I mean, they're all building up. They can't wait for the fight.
I can't wait.
But I mean, Henry Wharton hasn't exactly mixed in the same sort of company as Nigel Benn.
I don't think he's boxed the same caliber of opponent. That's what I'm bearing in mind when I'm making this conclusion. He's boxed guys that the only familiar opponent is Lou Gent, and Lou Gent lasted four ferocious rounds with Benn, whereas he drew with Wharton. So, you know, the form book's got to say Benn, you've got to go with the experience. But as I say, this guy's got such a terrific punch, anything can happen. But again, I'll reiterate, I'm going to go with Benn.
Thanks, Barry. Almost feel your excitement sitting right next to you. Let's pop down to ringside and see the feelings there. Gary Newbon has with him Don King and Frank Warren. Gary.
Yes, they're the new little and large partnership in boxing, and they're going to bring us some tremendous fights, big name world championship fights on ITV. We've got Don King, of course, the man with the great hairstyle, and his new partner, Frank Warren, who recently Don described as faster than a moving bullet. Don, what night are we in for tonight?
In for a terrific night tonight. You've just seen a competitive match there with another upset, and a demonstration that we put the best against the best, and this is what the people want, the customers, the recipient of a great night of boxing. And so we have in store for you a fight that's going to be a barn burner with Nigel Benn and sweetbread Henry Wharton.
Frank, I know out of you I'll get a prediction. Who's going to win this big battle?
I fancy Nigel Benn. I fancy him very strongly in a very tough fight. But I think he's got the experience and the firepower to stop Henry Wharton.
Okay, well, let's bring in John McCruick, who knows what the betting is tonight. John.
Well, are we in for a major upset? Now, the Dark Destroyer, a classic warrior, 5-2-1, they bet him, but 9-4 against Henry Wharton, and the money has been going on him. Smaller bets at 9-4, 28-1 the draw. But here, we haven't got a Don King, we've got King Don! A man with all his subjects here, King Don. But let me tell you this, a harder man to get money out of than you, and he's hard enough, is Mickey Duff, the manager of Wharton. He's back, Wharton, aren't you worried? King Don?
I don't know who's the crazier of the two, Jim.
Yeah, who knows that one, Gary. Mickey Duff apparently has put a very sizable bet on his man, Wharton. A lot of his punters have backed Wharton as well to create an upset here. This one could be an absolute classic. We'll be right back. From Earls Court, Henry Wharton and Nigel Benn are just about to come into the ring, but a few moments ago a wonderful round of applause for Michael Watson. It's so good to see Michael Watson out and about again. There he is in the tracksuit. Great to see him at ringside and to show the boxing has a caring heart. Michael Watson got a fantastic ovation in here. It's wonderful to see him at ringside once again. Okay, so the two fighters all set to go. Let's join the fellow who's just about the best ring announcer in the world, I would think, Jimmy Lennon Jr.
Ladies and gentlemen, prepare to welcome to the ring the WBC number one ranked super middleweight contender, Henry Wharton.
Henry Wharton, very calm, likeable fella. I asked him earlier this week when the fight face comes on. He says it never does. And he is backed here by thousands. I reckon there's 100 relations of Wharton in that crowd. 5,000 of them have come south. And as John McGregor's been saying, they've been backing their hunch. This fellow will be the new world champion with hard cash. Never ever been knocked over as a professional. He knows he's going to experience all sorts of pain tonight. This will be my hardest fight, but I'll come through it. The words of the unbeaten challenger, Henry Wharton. Terrific support for Wharton. He is the Commonwealth champion, of course. Later tonight, he hopes to be the world champion. A fantastic left hooker and a man with an iron chin as well. And a bit subdued, Nigel Benn. I've seen him knock him over in Windsor, in Aberavon, in Wisbeach. And then he's graduated to the venues like Atlantic City, Las Vegas, Rome and Old Trafford. He knows he's coming to the end. But his ambition is to go out with what he calls a good old-fashioned tear-up. The reigning world champion, Nigel Benn.
for the main event of the evening, Strictly Business, brought to you by Don King Productions and Sports Network. Promoters Don King and Frank Warren, as sponsored by Corona Beer and the Daily Mirror. This bout is sanctioned by the World Boxing Council, the President Jose Suleiman, and the Supervisor John Morris. Along with the British Boxing Board of Control, the steward in charge is also the President of the Board, Sir David Hopkins. Presenting the physicians at ringside, Dr. Stephen Shapiro, Mr. Pat Whitfield. Introducing the timekeeper at the bell, also keeping count of the knockdowns, Bob Edgeworth. And introducing to you the judges at ringside, Adrian Morgan, Sid Nathan, Rudy Ortega, and presenting the referee in charge of this bout. He'll be giving instructions after the introductions, working in this, his 84th world title bout, Tony Perez. All right, fans, here we go with the main event of the evening. And now, ladies and gentlemen in attendance, and boxing fans joining us around the world, it's showtime! The WBC Super Middleweight Championship of the World, scheduled for 12 rounds of boxing. Introducing to you first the challenger, on my left, fighting out of the red corner. He is wearing white trunks and fighting out of York in the north of England. His weight, 11 stone, 13 and a half pounds, or 167 and one half pounds. His unblemished record includes 18 wins, no losses, one draw, with 13 wins coming by way of knockout. Please welcome the former British Commonwealth Super Middleweight Champion and current WBC number one ranked Super Middleweight contender, introducing the undefeated challenger, Henry Sweetbread. His opponent across the ring, on my right, the defending champion, fighting out of the blue corner. He is wearing black trunks with white lettering, and he hails from Beckenham, Kent, by way of Ilford. He weighed in at an even 12 stone, or 168 pounds. His tremendous record includes 37 wins, 2 losses, 1 draw, with 32 big wins coming by way of knockout. Here is the former WBO middleweight champion and current defending WBC super middleweight champion of the world. Tonight, making his fifth defense of his title, please welcome the hard-hitting champion known as the Dirt Destroyer, Nigel Benn. Once again, here's the referee in charge. Now the instructions, Tony Perez.
It's a very big fight live. It's a huge sporting occasion. And to guide you through it, the top team, Jim Watt, and first of all, Reg Guttridge.
And most important, protect yourself at all times. Shake hands and come out of boxing.
So the final words then, all the fighting words are over, the trimmings are finished. And now let's go down to action. It's going to be the loneliest place in the world now for these boys. The usual. Well, almost emotive words here, and everybody's so pleased to see Michael Watson. This is where he fought Chris Eubank. The first time when Jim and I thought he deserved the decision. So there you go. Now then, as Baron McGugin says, don't look away, don't blink, because it could all happen with one hit. Who knows? A lot of maturity now in Nigel Benn's fighting. He doesn't do what he used to call the tear-ups really in the early stages against, again, his description, the Mexican road sweepers. As you recall, a draw last time up with Chris Eubank at Old Trafford in October. And, well, a lot of us feel that, but for that low punch, when he deducted it, lost a point, that he might have won that fight. However, very subjective to scoring the boxing. But by and large, I hope a little bit better than the recent ice skating.
What nice and tight already, Reg, and who can blame him? A good positive start from Benn with a jab. Not getting too close, but just trying to open him up with the jab. Wharton just thinking really defence, get the first round by. He must be feeling the nerves, I would imagine, more than Benn. Benn's been at this level so often.
He's a very laid-back character in his way, Henry Wharton. I can understand why he's got a massive support in the north. I've seen too much of him in London. We could do with seeing a lot more. Now, the contrast of people, and only really the eyes are the same, and, well, they're ice cubes. Midway through the opening round, Tony Perez handled one of the great Ali Frazier fights in New York. Just covering himself up sensibly there, Wharton, trying to block those hooks with a high guard. Followers of the fight game, Jim, he looks just like Mark Rowe, who held the middleweight championship of Britain some years ago now.
See, Benn is known for looking for a knockout in the first minute of a lot of his fights, and I think that's what Wharton's been told. Nice and tight, especially in the first minute, then maybe loosen up a little bit, get some punches off. That's what he's done. He's done nothing really for the first minute, just had a good look at Benn. Now he's maybe trying to look for some targets.
Spent a lot of time getting in shape for this. There's a lot of money at stake. Wharton went to Florida, and unfortunately his trainer was mugged in the gymnasium, so he came out, they went to Marbella, and meanwhile Benn was tuning up in Tenerife. Punches early on, that's what these pro fighters want to do. There's the corner man now. Old firm though, it's become, isn't it? Peter DeFreitas is his personal manager, and self-managed officially, Nigel Benn, and of course very experienced Jimmy Tissot, him in a lot of other fights, and indeed pros. There you are, keep your hands up, he's saying. Protect yourself from the hooks. And there's the think tank, as it were, in the challenger's corner. Mickey Duff's leaning through the ropes there. Who's the manager, and there's Terry O'Neill, a little man in the ring, being with Wharton from the start. And the cut man, if needed, Denny Mancini.
Second out, round two.
Certain kind of self-assurance again with Benn. He's always been a confident fighter, but he's just become a bit more compact, and Jimmy Simpson's done a good job on him, hasn't he, Jim, really?
Yeah, he's a lot more controlled now. I mean, Nigel just used to look for a knockout punch, every punch he throws, but now he's so controlled, he thinks more about pacing. I mean, Nigel was always looking for the finisher, and so he would go tired in the last half of a fight. But I was impressed against Eubank that he really paced the fight well, and he's doing that here. Just used the jab in the first round there, which I thought he nicked. And now Wharton's coming back. Wharton's in his look.
Well, Wharton knows now he's got to start unleashing a punch or two now, reminding Benn that this is not going to be an easy one. And left hook, his favourite punch. Remember, people forget that Benn can box a bit. He was the ABA champion. Like Ben's going for the body a bit as well, trying to bring those hands down. One of the old axioms of the fight business is work to the body and a head mass fall.
And Ben's quite prepared to be the first one to lead off Reg. He's actually putting Wharton on the defensive here. A good positive start from Nigel Benn.
So midway through the second schedule, of course, of 12 championship fights, WBC version. 12 shown exactly, Benn. 11, 13 and a half, Wharton.
Okay, right.
Wharton's just a little bit tight at the moment, Reg. He's going to have to settle down a little bit, relax a little bit more. He has to keep his defences sound, just loosen up a little bit.
Well, you know, Jim, you can't blame him in his first World Championship fight being a little bit hesitant at the start. If he got him winging punches, he might have got nailed. Oh, tried a chop punch there. They've landed on the back of the neck. That would not have been welcomed. The jab up there, a bit of a post and his neck punch, that one. So, end of the second. Throw it in gum. We're back then for round three. And it's been very cautious, a very sensible start actually by both of them, I thought.
Ben's been cautious, Reg, but he's quite keen to lead off. His jab's been working well in the first couple of rounds.
Yeah, doing a bit of boxing.
And he's keeping his chin down nice and tight. He's paying Wharton full respect. He's quite prepared to let some punches go. Wharton must loosen up a little bit.
He's definitely working to the body as much as he can there, Ben. It's always been his forte anyway. Little bit of caution there, Jim. They're both right in the lead there. One trying to fight the other one into a lead so they can counter.
And you can actually feel the tension in the ring, Reg. I mean, one mistake and the other fella's going to be under the floor. They both have the power. But Ben getting the punches off Beck at the moment.
It's inevitable with punches though, Jim, aren't they? They're both saying, hey, this is red alert here, we've got to watch ourselves. It'd be foolish of them to rush in and take chances because they can both fight.
They're going to let some go now. I've given Ben the first couple of rounds and he won them without really wasting too much punches. So as far as the 12 round distance goes, that's a good start for Ben.
Yeah, he doubled that jab up again there. Good points for him to start this. Got American, Welsh and English judges.
Going to have to try to start coming forward a bit more, Reg. He's been backed up all the way and Ben loves it if he can back the opponents up. He's got to try to come forward.
They look a little bit better at the back of the hall than they do close up as well, Jim, there. They're punching the wall and they're hitting him on down. He's out the ropes there. He's got to let him. He's trying to fight from outside the rope. Well done. He just caught him on the arms a bit too much there, didn't he, Wharton, when he unloaded.
Maybe let the punches go.
Yeah, let them go, yeah, sure.
He's just a little bit too tense at the moment, what?
And it's the fourth round. Good start by Nigel Benn. A little bit cautious, and there's the unofficial card of Brad McGuigan. Yes, three rounds up, he's made him. Just a little rebuke there from Tony Perez. Just behave yourself there, pulling on and throwing punches like that.
If think probably controlled is a better way of describing Ben's first three rounds rather than cautious, because he's always ready to let the punches go. He's worked well behind the jab. Wharton, for me, is far too tight, too tense. And he's not going to outbox Ben at this rate. And he can't just depend on a knockout. He's got to do more work. He's got to open up a little bit.
He seems sort of lying back there, Wharton, saving himself or something. I don't think that's going to be in his favour. So last time he did that, he got a draw with a land on a new gent, which was highly disputed, and Ben really destroyed the new gent in London. Missing him with that derby jab, is he?
His jab is working so well, Reg. I mean, it's unusual for Ben to face a man he doesn't have to go looking for. Some good shots from Wharton there. He has to sustain this.
There's a sort of look on Ben's face like, hello, hello, the lads unloading some punch and I'll take those, there's no trouble. Talking about searching for openings there, Jim, they really are, aren't they? Certainly Ben is.
Ben's jab is working so well in the first three rounds.
See, if not the, quote, Ben's words, the tear-up and the blast-hard fight that people expected, but it could be working up to that, though, couldn't it, Jeff?
See, Ben doesn't have to do that, Red. He's winning the rounds without wasting any punches. He's so controlled. Wharton's not doing enough in any of the rounds. You know, the only time Wharton's letting punches go is when Ben's already up close, and by that time, Ben has landed a couple of jabs on the way in.
Too much of the Wharton famed left hook, really.
It's because he's allowing Ben to lead off all the time. Wharton must do more leading off if they want to get into this fight.
Well, it looks like a barber shop there at the moment, doesn't it? All quiet and calm and collected. So have a look at this double jab coming up, Jim.
Ben's jab is working so well, very accurate, very controlled, his chin's down. Bang, bang, two perfect left jabs.
This is on technique. He comes in there, Ben. You got a little counter-attack coming in by Wharton.
Not enough from Wharton, Reg. A couple of punches inside, but not enough. Ben's work is always looking better.
Quick rub down there by Mr. Mancini and a few harsh words in the air. There it is. You go and do it or else. Five. That's the corner man's job there, especially with experience. Bit of a think tank there in Wharton's corner. And it's also being matched by Jimmy Tibbs in the other corner.
Lovely punch from Ben.
Yeah, right through the middle there, right above us.
I don't know if this is part of Wharton's tactics, Reg, or if he's frozen a little bit. He's certainly not really got down to work yet.
Oh, well, a little bit of an armistice there. Sorry about that. Wharton wanted a race right in after him. Now, this, to coin your phrase a lot now, Jim, Ben sort of fancies the job a bit more now, doesn't he? He wants to start steaming in a bit.
You know, he doesn't really want to change what he's doing. If he can win rounds in a 12-rounder without wasting any punches, without exerting himself over the... And that's what you want to keep doing. Nick every round you can, then when the reach is a hard part, you've still got something left. But Wharton is the one who really has to get down to work. He's been doing nothing. Throwing some punches up close, but he has to do more leading off. Has to get his own jab working.
It is a big step in experience and ability here, isn't it, by Wharton?
Little signs, Reg, that Wharton is frozen a little bit. I mean, he hasn't been prepared to take the fight with the scruff of the neck and take it to Ben, and that's what you must do. When you're in a big puncher, you must try to back him up. Wharton has never once tried to back Ben up. He's allowed Ben to control the action, and he's winning all rounds.
Yeah, and he's hanging on there too, like a limpet with the right hand arm, I should say, Wharton.
See, even when Wharton throws a punch, you can see he's still thinking about defence. As soon as the punch is out, he's pulling his elbows down and his chin down. He's just paying too much respect to Benn at the moment.
Minute to go in the fifth round, WBC version of the Super Middleweight Championship. So Wharton's actually trying to have a chance of Henry. Henry coming from the audience. There's quite a really come down in the coach loads and bus loads and probably caravans too, because he comes from a travelling family. Born in Leeds and raised in York.
See, Wharton hasn't really let any full-blooded shots go because he's almost on the defensive. He's almost reacting to what Ben's just done. So he's not really setting himself for getting the full power into his shots. He really has to think about leading off if he wants to get into this fight.
Sensation there at the end of the fifth round, and the referee just signaled out here, yes, he considered that a knockdown, although Benn complained about a punch on the back of the head. It's apparently he thought a left hook just before that, and he's called it a knockdown. Now,
but that's what Wharton needed, Reg. He needed something to get his hat into this fight. Now we'll see if he pours heart and soul into what's going to happen now. He really has to weaken up his ideas.
The WBC always say to the judges, you've got to take a point off if the man scores a knockdown. I don't necessarily agree with that.
Oh, a different man altogether has come out to start this round, Reg, from Henry Wharton's corner. Now he fancies the job.
That's the first signs of a good uppercut there from him, wasn't it? And there, the left hook. It takes a punch well there. Has done it in the past, in many ways, but still chin to match the heart, I think. Now we're getting some reaction from the Wharton supporters. I've been seeing that, well, maybe it was disputed knockdown as far as the judges are concerned. They've got to go by the referee's instruction. Right hand now, not the left hook that he's talked about.
Yeah, but he's coming back with a full-bodied counter now. He's not just kind of chapping inside as he was earlier. Now he's getting power into his punches. Now Benn has to think a bit more about defence.
Well, they're laying in a little bit now. They're getting stiffer round by round, these punches, aren't they? Oh, they got a move with that, but it actually went past.
Kind of lost his composure a little bit, Reg. He's building forward now. He's not putting the same thought into his boxing. He's just putting his forehead down and kind of pushing himself forward. It's not the thoughtful boxing we saw in the first four rounds.
Oh, long right hand there. That got home and almost after the bell, that one. It's okay, they've made it, but that's a good sign. It was right on the bell anyway, and as I've often said before, sometimes you can hear the bell watching at home and it can't be heard in the arena, although that bell was very clear to everybody, I think. So now this is what we want to see, the knockdown from the round before, Jim. Ah, the left hook, it was. You see that he was stumbling a bit there, and then he got caught. That's it. Now the next punch, that one, hits him on the back of the neck, but then he still regards as a knockdown, the referee, you agree? And yeah, this is the end of this round before you answer that. That's a Ned with a right, got away with a cracking punch there.
Ben's left, still working well, but he's a little bit more careless in that round, which is Steve.
Corners, 10 seconds.
Would you have considered that a knockdown, Jim?
Yeah, I think so, Reg. It was Ben's fault that he got caught in the top of the head because it was bending down low.
Right, round seven. Well, there you are. It's got it a bit closer than I have, actually, there. But then again, deduction of point my matter there. Premier Gwiggins, very unofficial, of course, got been one round ahead, or 1 point ahead.
I wouldn't have scored the 10-8 round, Reg. I think I'll just give that to Wharton, the 10-9. I don't think he was clearly winning the round before the knockdown, so I've got it slightly more in Ben's favour. But the main thing is, Wharton, for his own point of view, has got himself back into the fight. He's letting punches go and full-bodied shots at that.
Using a little bit of a touch of shoulders and forearms in those clinches.
Still good jabs from Ben.
Yeah.
Not controlling the fight the way he was earlier, Reg, but still jabbing well, but Wharton right back into it now.
He does hang on tight with the right arm there, doesn't he, Wharton? I don't blame him. He's protecting his grips as well and trying to stop Ben from punching inside, but the referee's got to break them. He tried the uppercut there, Jim Wharton. Well, he certainly reverted to his out of the style, doing a bit of boxing as well as the punch power there, Nigel Benn.
He broke the gum shield.
Yeah, the referee would have to pick it up and stop the bell at the appropriate moment to replace that.
Now's a good time.
Yeah, he'll do that now. It's a medical rule. He's just skipped it back to the corner as well there, Wharton. So they have to watch and put it back, but they do take the time off. There we go. As well covered there from the cameraman, who got everything in hand. You were right in there with him.
Well, I said earlier Wharton would have to start backing Ben up if he wants into the fight. He started trying to do that now. Now he's got a chance to get some power into his own shots. Ben just lost a little bit of his composure, looks a little bit ragged at times.
Yeah,
his own defence, a little open ridge.
Yeah, a little bit of the impetus. Referee had a job getting out of the way there as Wharton backed up. He's still a nippy referee though, Tony Prayers. Talking to him the whole time there, Perez. He's trying not to interfere there. That's good referees like to do that. Control it from away from the boxes by word and not by strength. Well, they're settled down a bit now, Jim, isn't it?
There was more even action now because
Terry O'Neill. Yeah, Terry O'Neill was in the corner, seen a lot. Well, let's have a look at that gunshot flying out there, Jim. I'll just also point out that if a boxer spits it out deliberately, probably more than once, then a referee can take points away.
Well, it was certainly knocked out.
That was knocked out, yeah, certainly. I didn't suggest it was anything else, but just to fill you in with the rules, he can take a point away if they continually spit the gun. A little dab of a nosebleed there early on, Ben, but it didn't seem to matter. Get that in the schoolyard, probably, say. Coming out early for work in the eighth round. Here's Gary Newbon with Mickey Duffin in the corner.
Mickey Henry's really getting back into this.
Yeah. It's a case. He's the better fighter if he believes in himself. It's a big occasion, and the only way we'll lose the fight is if the occasion gets the best of him, because he's got the ability to win. He should be taking a good shot.
Got caught by the board.
So there you are, Mickey Dawson. He has the ability to win, but no doubt that Nigel Benn would disagree with that.
Well, the most significant thing, there was a gun shot again, that was a good right hand lead.
Chopping punch as well, look at it. He travelled a long way, but he got the message, didn't he? See, the second time up now with the shield, and he's asking the cameraman to throw it back. They've got it in their latch there. And he doesn't want to waste things up. See, there's some boo there that he stopped it. The referee's perfectly in order to do so. Certainly wasn't Wharton's fault there, he got it knocked out. But obviously it takes the play away a little bit from Ben there, as he was just on top, obviously.
Ben's hands are going round behind Wharton when they're up close now. He's not getting the punches off the same way as he was earlier. That's more like it from Ben.
He's generally got control though, Ben, hasn't he?
Yeah, he's boxing well, very well controlled. He's just a little bit looser now than he was in the first four rounds. Wharton was doing exactly what Ben wanted him to do, backing off with a tight defence, not throwing too many. But now Wharton's trying to back him up, and it's much tougher for Ben. See, Ben just a little bit ragged at times now. Wharton's still very controlled.
I think Ben's accepted the fact now that Wharton does absorb a good punch, because that was a cracker. He's knocked over a lot of people with that type of punch in the past, Jim.
It was a lovely right hand leading that caught Wharton bang in the chin, but as you say, it didn't shake him.
He's advertising himself there, actually, on the short, saying no fear he has there on the waistband, Ben. Something about the Ministry of Sound is the other emblem.
Ben hasn't been using the jab in the last couple of rounds either.
Remember, this fight's been shown well halfway around the world. It's been shown on the pay television Showtime in America, and the Don King and Frank Warren bid was £1,575,000 for this bit, of which Ben gets a 75%. And if you're thinking, well, I wouldn't mind fighting for that kind of money, I don't think you'd want to put the work in that these fellas do and take the punches. Let's have a little replay of that right-hand punch that leads in here and knocks out the shield, Jim.
Just crouch down, good for the spot, bang, lovely punch. Wharton was all right, he was looking for the follow-up punch and slipped inside it. But lovely right-hand leads,
he comes again.
A moving target over with the right-hand, bang. Wharton still looking at him, ducked here from the left.
Well, that's it, they're really stirring him up in the corner there, aren't they? Remember, it was the team of Mancini and Duff that got Michael Watson to defeat Ben at Finsbury Park, and it's good to see Michael Watson back watching this one. Ninth round. Have you got it now, Jim? There's Barry's, you see, he's got a couple of points up with Ben.
Yeah, but still got Ben in front. What would worry me if I was in Ben's camp is the fact he's just a little bit more ragged than he was earlier on. He's trying some wild right hands, which he wasn't doing earlier. You have to expect the longer the fight goes and the harder when you begin to tire a little bit. He's making some mistakes now, Ben.
He's no longer the wild swinging man, you know that. It was really the hours he must have been putting in the gymnasium with this, with coaching. Lily's trying today, you see this, he's when he's saying, come on, when are you going to lead to me? I want to shoot the counter punch, and they're right above you and whatnot here.
Wharton's trying to work behind a jab now.
You need just a touch of the desperation stakes now, Wharton, didn't the gym. So let's unload, take a little bit of a chance. I think you have to do that.
Ben's experience in the ropes there, serving him well. He's keeping his chin out of trouble. Wharton has some pinned there, but not really having a chance to capitalise on it. See, he's a little bit hesitant to move in and let the punches go. See, this is what Ben is dangerous with his back to the ropes.
Okay, he uses him like a pole a bit at times. You're not supposed to unfairly use him, but I wasn't suggesting that, but he does. Ali was great at that too.
Wharton still managing to back Ben up. Is that lovely right hand lead again. Ben a lot looser at the edge, a lot more ragged. I wonder maybe if he's feeling the pace. He's putting a lot of good work in the first nine rounds here. Wonder if he's just starting to feel the pace.
Well, he's certainly done some miles of road work out in Tenerife, I know that for sure. Whether he did enough boxing in the gym, I'm not sure about that. There's some suggestion that perhaps he didn't. And obviously you all know from the World Championship that it's so important, the sparring and the preparation.
Well, with Jimmy Tibbs training them already, I think the job will be done properly. Tibbs certainly one of the best in the game, and we're very surprised if anything has been left to chance in Ben's preparation. But he set a good pace, and you have to remember Wharton did very little work in the first four rounds, so maybe he's feeling the stronger now.
So over to Gary, he's got Peter De Freitas with him.
Peter, how does the Nigel Benn camp see this at the moment?
We feel that we've won every round. At the moment, he's working well behind the jab.
Well, he wouldn't have won the round where he was knocked down.
Yeah, well, I mean, apart from that, did he take a point off? We didn't know that.
Well, we think it's a knockdown for replay.
Okay, so we've won every other round. He's working well behind the jab. He's doing what the corner is asking him to do. And we're very happy he's boxing like a world champion.
And what about Wharton?
Well, he's strong and he's durable. And we're just working behind the jab, opening him up through the middle and let things work off the jab.
So you just the message is keep it going?
Keep it going and just keep working behind the jab. Right off the jab.
So there you are, that's the word from the upper camp then. Coming up for the 10th. And, well, you might be just a little bit too anxious here, saying he's won every round, Jim.
Yeah, slight exaggeration. I mean, Wharton is the man who allowed his opponent to have the big lead at the start of the fight, so he's given himself a mountain to climb. So he's the one who really has to raise the pace and keep it up. I mean, the signs that Ben's tiring of it, he's still dangerous, he still has the power.
Yeah,
he's still a bit ragged, and that's usually a sign of tiredness.
What about the old soldier there, Ben, from the Royal Fusiliers, wanting you to get a touch of the collateral bombing stakes there, didn't he? Winging away if he could.
See, I always feel that too much of the time Wharton has just been a little bit hesitant to let his punches flow. And he's backing Ben to the ropes, but he's as always, he's a bit worried about letting some punches go in case he gets tagged for the counter. You've got to go out and win world titles. This is good stuff from Wharton here.
He's ducking a bit too low. He's not supposed to duck below the waistline. The referee hasn't interfered at all.
See, Ben won rounds clearly at the start of the fight, but a lot of the following rounds have been very tight, very difficult to score.
Sid Nathan and Adrian Morgan from Britain. Julia Tiger from San Francisco. All three of them are referees as well, or both Nathan Barry Todd. He's a little bit messy there, Ben, isn't he? I'm surprised at that, too.
He's lost a lot of his composure, Reggie. He's quite often he's finding his head in some funny positions here. I really feel that's a sign of tiredness.
Yeah, he might be hurt by body fatigue. It's unlikely when he...
But he has put in a lot of work range, a lot of good shots. Wharton saved himself in the earlier rounds and he's still looking strong.
And so far he's certainly absorbed a very good punch, hasn't he, Wharton? Oh, full break when he tried it with an uppercut. But I got a little bit of a finger wagging from the referee at Wharton for that. He's catching Benn a bit now.
See, the fact that Wharton is now pushing Benn back, he has more room to let his punches go, so he's performing better. A lot of close rounds now, Rez, and the fact that Wharton's pushing them back might just sway them slightly in his favour.
Well, there's been a lot of firing from the hit there from Benn. And as you say, gentlemen, it's starting to get back into the fight now, Henry Wharton. Matter of fact, looks like Wharton was actually grinning up the corner there when he seemed to get better of a couple of exchanges with Benn. I've got that impression anyway. Told you he was a laid-back sort of a crowd, hasn't he?
Well, Wharton's the one who's working his improved edge. He's backing Benn up a lot more. Benn has lost a bit of his composure. Wharton still finds it difficult to catch him cleanly because he's still showing that little bit of hesitancy. He's certainly boxing better.
And manager Mickey Duff there in the corner of him, turning the crowd, waving along, saying, come on, cheer for your man. He needs the cheers. He certainly gets them when he fights and leads. The 11th round, man. And there's Barry's unofficial again there, a couple of points up. Notice he put a 10-8 round there early on with the knockdown. I think the overall of the boxer might have forecast him, fancied it going 12 rounds. I must say I'm a bit surprised. I thought it was, well, either way, could have ended inside, and obviously...
Yeah, well, they both have the power, Reg, to finish. It was one of those fights when you just never knew what was quite was going to happen. But I thought maybe a stoppage round about the 8th or 9th, maybe somebody making a mistake and being punished for it. Well, Wharton's not messing about, Reg. He was ready to lay in on that.
Yeah, he was having a little sit on the ropes there. He was getting a bit too casual, Ben was.
Forget the sportsmanship. Let's go on with the fight, I think. Benn again looking a bit tired. See, the trouble with Wharton, Reg, he hasn't had too many real big rounds where you could say he won them clearly. I mean, even at the round where they scored the knockdown, I thought it was pretty itchy peachy and the knockdown let him win the round, but not clearly. Ben really digs deep when he has to. You've got to hand it to him, yes. He really digs deep.
He was holding on to the top rope at the same time there.
Gum shield again from Wharton.
Yeah, third time. Now he'll stop it there and put it back. So he waits for the appropriate moment. And Jimmy Tibbs calling out to Ben, take deep breaths. That's it, and he's doing it as well, and you're watching him doing that again. The wash and brush up, and back goes the gum shield. And that's now obligatory to wear that.
See, whenever the going really gets tough, Benn digs deep, and just everything he's got, he pours it out. That's why you can never grudge him the success he's had. Never complains when the going gets rough, just keeps going. Has managed to pin Benn to the ropes, he hasn't managed to capitalise as much. Look, he's missed every one of those punches there.
Yeah, exactly.
See, he's pinned him to the ropes, but Ben's experience has kept him out of trouble, and that's Wharton's problem where the points are concerned. he needed more big rounds behind him.
Yeah, there's points for defence as well, of course. Doesn't seem to be too favourable with judges nowadays. So, a round to go. And the crowd like that little bang up there. I don't think they realise that some of those punches were missing by Wharton. See, we can hear them in the corner there. Well, the final words now, hoping their man can do it in the last. And the referee reminding both boxers that this is the last round. Smile there by Ben, you know, when he permits himself a smile, it shows he knows he's happy with the way things are going.
Well, good start to the round from Ben.
Yeah, he really looks lively in the last, doesn't he?
See, this will look good from the back of the hall with Wharton going forward.
Yeah.
But he's
exactly.
Not getting the punches home. Ben's defensive boxing really has been sound.
Chops and stamping there on the floor for Henry, and certainly not Cooper, who's at the ringside doing a radio broadcast. They've been dying for something to cheer now, the Wharton supporters. And as Jim Watt rightly says, they're probably a little bit fooled at the back of the arena that these punches are landing. Well, it's the final fling, isn't it, for Wharton, and he needs it.
But Ben wants to throw some back as well there. He's slipping the punch as well, but he wants to work a bit more as well. He'll give the ring to Wharton if he doesn't work with him. It's not enough just to bob and weave. He's got to come back with some counters.
Midway then. With Wharton now, even though they're not all landing, it's going to count.
Ben will give him the round, Rez, because he's not coming back with enough punches of his own. Slipping and sliding, but you've got to let the punches go as well.
Oh, yeah, he's coming back now. He's going to give it the final look. He does love, as he says, a tear up, Ben. A minute.
Well, I think Wharton's what rate Reg has taken the last round for him, but personally I don't think enough. I think Ben still holds his title. You have to remember the whole 12 rounds. Wharton gave him a 4-round start, and that's a big start in a 12-rounder.
They're going to need some security around here now. The rings already look like a carnival in a car park. It's already started. Referee collecting the cards. Sid Nathan just beside us here has handed his card in. Former Starbred referee, now the WBC judge. He's actually applauding the contest. Well, what a nice finish there. A couple of old pals. Right through that, they showed a lot of respect for each other, didn't they?
Yep, sportsmanship all the way through. Wharton, I thought, Reg, just took too long to get started. He gave away the first 4 rounds. You can't do that. That's a third of the fight gone before he get into the fight. A lot of close rounds. He's going to go on either way, but I feel Nigel Benn has kept his title by a couple of points.
There he is. That's nice there. Ben's Sam, well done. Well, I've got Ben as the winner, Jim, and you have too.
Yeah, what, probably give Wharton the last round just because he defended too much, didn't come back with enough punches, but still Wharton just left a little bit too late. Wharton needed some more real big rounds. Even when he was backing Ben up, he wasn't capitalising enough. He was missing too much.
Yeah,
just a little bit of lack of technique, maybe lack of experience.
I've got a bit of faith in these judges, Jim. You know, they're very experienced here. They're tried and tested, so we know what they can do. So I don't think they'll come up with a silly decision. Not even split. So all the money there that they've given for it. Well, there you are. Just got him up by 1 point. I think it might be a bit more than that, but we'll see. That's unofficial of Barry. And it seems like the sponsors have got their money's worth again tonight, the Daily Mirror. And the girls getting in the ring there, ready to hoist the flags. Always tension time now for fighters. I think by the look of it, when you see Ben wanting to chat everybody and relaxing, he's saying, I know I've won this. So here it comes. So the American MC, Jimmy Lennon, here's the result.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 12 rounds of boxing, we have a unanimous decision.
Well, that's something.
I will read the score totals. Judging ringside, Sid Nathan scores the bout 116-114. Rudy Ortega scores the bout 117-112. Adrian Morgan scores the bout 116-113. All three in favor of the winner. And still,
yeah, Nigel Benn, perhaps a bit of a big one there by Rudy Ortega, 117-112. But good judging by the British judges there, 116-113, 116-114. Only a couple of rounds. That's about right, Jim, isn't it, with you?
Yeah, that's fine with me. Yep, definitely. Ben was almost in front. Wharton gave him too much of a start, left himself with too much of a
mark. Ladies and gentlemen, have a hand of recognition for an outstanding effort and a fine sportsman. Have a hand for Henry Wharton.
Well, the crowd generally approve of that, and I think the Wharton fans, with the sound of it, have accepted it. And he's certainly a sporting character. His chance will come again, I'm sure.
Well, then, a standing ovation for the fighters here at Earls Court, and they really deserved it. For what it's worth, I had Nigel Benn winning by three rounds. We're going to look to talk to both fighters, to Nigel Benn and to Henry Wharton, who made such a brave challenge for Benn's world title. And there's more world championship action as well, and that's coming up after the break. We've seen a terrific fight. We've seen Nigel Benn retain his WBC 12-stone title. A great challenger from Henry Wharton. And both fighters are now talking to Gary Newbon.
Well, as ever, Nigel, involved in a terrific fight.
Oh, being honest with you, he is the toughest guy I fought. I'm not just
tougher than Eubank?
Oh, yeah. Punch, Eubank's got a hard chin, but no one knows. He punches hard, very hard. Very, very hard.
He's got a good chin as well.
Very good chin. But I thought to myself, I ain't going to go out there and try and burn myself out. I know he's a tough guy. So I thought, it's a big, you know, this is his dream. You know, I've been there and I'm getting on. He's still young. He'll have another shot, you know.
Henry, was that a difference in the early stages? By the way, this is your daughter, Lydia, we ought to explain, who's 3 years of age, and your wife gave birth to a son, Henry Jr., last week. Congratulations on that. But you didn't do it tonight. Do you think it was the experience in the early rounds?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I knew it was going to be a long distance fight because Nigel's not going to go up from anything. I knew this was the toughest fight in my life. And I tried to come on towards then like I did try, but Nigel stayed with me. You know, Nigel Benn, the champion of the world, let's not forget that. I tried to take it off him. He tried to have a war at the end, and I knew he had the strength. I thought to myself, I'm just going to smother him. This is when, like, the old head comes into it now. I've been with Bartley, Michael Watson, Doug DeWitt,
Robbie Sims, Eubanks, I've been in with them all. You know, the business is winning with Lugent, no disrespect to him. And now he's gone in with me, and he gave me a good workout. I tell you what, I never knew he was this strong. You know, if we want a rematch, we've got to talk a lot.
Actually, if you had a rematch, Henry, would you actually go flat out more from the start now?
Of course, I've learned something, but like Nigel's learned. You know, we'd both adopt different tactics. I'd adopt different tactics, he'd adopt different tactics. Whatever we play, he's a world champion. The world champions can turn their style to anything. You know, I try to turn a few different ways, try to box him a little, try to mix it up a little. You know, we try everything. We're world champions fighters.
Henry, very brave of it. Nigel, you're still the most exciting boxer in this country, and you are still world champion.
Thank you very much. Good fight, Henry. Yeah, thank you, mate. Good fight.
Yeah, thank you.
Terrific interview that, and a great feeling between the fighters. This whole boxing game takes a few knocks from a few quarters, but when you see two fighters like that giving their all and then behaving like that at the end, it really is quite admirable.